Welcome to BBC What's New. This month, on the 20th of June, people around the globe marked World Refugee Day to raise awareness of the situation of millions of children, women, and men who have had to leave their homes because of war or persecution. Last year, the United Nations recorded the highest ever number of displaced people in its history, and half of these are children. But why are the numbers of refugees growing, and what can be done to help? Let's find out.
In 2018, 25 people every minute were forcibly displaced, meaning they had to leave their homes, villages, even their countries because of war or persecution. The UN says that there are almost 71 million displaced people worldwide. That's double the number 20 years ago. This is growing because of increased tensions around the world. More than a third of all refugees now come from Syria, Myanmar, Afghanistan, South Sudan, and Somalia, where there are ongoing conflicts. Africa has been widely praised for taking in and hosting more refugees than any other region. In February, the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres said Western nations should learn from Africa's generosity and solidarity. Kenya, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Ethiopia, Sudan, and Uganda host the most refugees in Africa. Countries like Ethiopia and Uganda, for example, operate what's called an open door policy, which means they accept almost all the refugees who flee to their country for safety and rarely turn anyone away. Ethiopia has taken in more than 900,000 refugees from neighboring countries, making it the second largest refugee hosting country in Africa. Uganda hosts the most refugees in Africa and the third most in the world. Sadly, more than 82% of those refugees are women and children. To help these young people who have lost their homes, schools, and friends, the Ugandan government has teamed up with the charity Save the Children to create child-friendly spaces across their refugee camps. It also grants refugees free movement, employment opportunities, and gives them land to build new homes or farms. And the UN is now encouraging other countries to do the same.
So we've learned about why the number of people who've been displaced is growing. But how are young refugees coping in the camps? Our reporter Anthony met up with some students living in the Kakuma refugee camp in Kenya to find out what life is like for them and what message they have for their political leaders back home.
We are at Kakuma Refugee Camp Secondary School, right at the heart of Kakuma Refugee Camp. The school has a population of more than 3,000 students. But that is not surprising, owing to the fact that this camp is one of the biggest in Africa. It has a population of more than 180,000 refugees. And this makes it one of the biggest cities here in Kenya. So today we are celebrating the World Refugee Day, and we are here at this school to speak to young people about their experiences and their aspirations in life.
A World Refugee Day, for me, I understand that it is a day for refugees to enjoy themselves, because as a refugee, we come from different countries. We come together and enjoy that day.
It's a special day which refugees meet one place and celebrate together.
I really enjoy being in this camp, because one of the things is that there are so many things that I get access to, like football and other freedom. Like in school, there are so many clubs that you are being given to enjoy.
In Kakuma, it's nice because we have a peace, we have free schools, we have free rations. So we are happy to live here, Kakuma.
It's good somehow, because here we have a free lesson, we learn free, but in our countries we are paying school fees. But we know one time we can succeed here, and then we go somewhere which will be better than here.
Actually, the life of in this camp actually is very good, because we sleep nicely and we work nicely and we're learning nicely.
Our food which are getting from ration is very little for us to consume in this month.
We have lack of food first and lack of water.
My advice is to be our president, is to promote the citizen, promote the peace, and neutralize the school government to decrease the war.
In our country, in my background country, I will tell him to maintain the country and make peace for us to be back in our countries.
I may tell them, may you stop fighting. I like it peace. We may have knowledge, skin, ability in our homelands.
There you have it, amazing young people. A lot of hope, aspirations, and clear messages to their leaders. Back to you in studio, Debula.
Thanks, Anthony. Here's some other stories making headlines this week. First, to Thailand in East Asia, where a group of 12 teenagers and their football coach have marked the anniversary of the day they went missing in a huge underground cave. The Wild Boars team was exploring the cave before it flooded, trapping them for 17 days. The Wild Watch, as it took a team of over a dozen experienced divers to rescue them one by one. The team and the rescuers returned to the cave to pay tribute to the Thai Navy SEAL diver who died during the rescue operation, Saman Gunan. Next, to the United States and Yosemite National Park in California.
I just can't believe I just did that.
Where this 10-year-old girl has become the youngest person to climb the El Capitan vertical rock wall. American Sally Schneider was accompanied by her dad as she climbed the iconic 3,000-foot route in 5 days. Wow, it took a year to prepare for and meant that she was able to add to her family's history with El Capitan, as it's where her parents met. Aww. And finally, to Botswana in Southern Africa, where more than 500 vultures have been killed after eating poisoned elephant carcasses. They were all from endangered or critically endangered species of the bird. Vultures circling a carcass can be seen from miles away, so poachers often poison them to prevent their activity being tracked. And if you'd like to find out more about the vulture and why it's such an important species, just go to our YouTube page and look for our Behind the Headlines playlist, where you'll find loads of interesting videos about things like wildlife, science, politics, and other important issues are happening around the world. That's at youtube.com/BBCWhat'sNew.
Hey guys, my name is Mr. Easy and you're watching BBC What's New. Zagadat.
Next, if you're a football fan, you'll have been watching the Women's World Cup, which is currently being held in France. But there's been some controversy, though, in the knockout stages. And Isaac from BBC Sport Africa is here to tell us more. Hi, Isaac.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good. So, tell me about the African teams at the tournament.
Well, we've had Nigeria, Cameroon and South Africa take part. South Africa were knocked out in the group stages, but Nigeria and Cameroon qualified to the next round, but they both lost.
Oh no, but England versus Cameroon match, there was some controversy.
Yeah, there was loads of controversy. Cameroon were very, very unhappy. They lost 3-0 in that match, and the second goal that England scored, Cameroon were very upset. They thought it was offside. VAR, the big talking point at this year's competition, came in and said that the goal was onside, and the Cameroon players stood around them. They were so upset, didn't want to play. And then they had a goal ruled out themselves, which would have brought them back into the game. So it was, yeah, a really, really tough day for the Cameroonian
women. So I bet there's been lots of reaction, especially on the continent, to this.
Yeah, there's been a real mixed reaction. Some people have sided with the Cameroonian players, looking at all the other VAR decisions that have gone against all the African teams and saying, you know, these women, you know, probably felt that this was us against the world, you know. But then there have been a lot of people who've been saying that it's a little bit embarrassing for African countries. So we went and spoke to a few young kids to find out what they thought about the Cameroonian women's team.
Pushing a referee is wrong. Fair play is important, even if you're at a disadvantage.
The Cameroonian girl that scored the goal was not offside. They shouldn't have disallowed the goal. They should have accepted it. We didn't like to see her cry. We shouldn't have lost 3-0, but 3-1.
To me, this game wasn't fair to the indomitable Lionesses. We also need to understand that once you're in the last 16, the competition gets harder. We were facing England, a tough team.
The goal from the English team was offside, but we accepted it. But the first goal from Cameroon was apparently offside, therefore not accepted.
I think it could be rigged. Even if we lost, we need to congratulate the Lionesses because they made it out of the group stage.
So you can see there's a bit of a mixed reaction there, and it will be interesting to see what happens with FIFA. I think the Cameroonian women's team are going to be in trouble with FIFA.
Oh, that sounds bad. Anyway, but what does it mean for women's football in general?
Well, there is no such thing as bad publicity, and so this will have definitely given women's football a big talking point. But there'll be someone who say that this isn't a good example for young African women.
And talking about young African women in football, one teen from Somalia has big dreams of one day representing her country. Ifra reckons she's better at football than most of the boys. And as we're about to see, Isaac, she may have a point.
Yeah, there's no official national women's team in the country, but that hasn't stopped Irfan from believing she can make it as a footballing superstar. This is her story.
I have never thought to quit playing football just because I am a girl and I believe I am better than most boys. Girls can do anything we want. My name is Ifran Mohammed Hassan and my nickname is Ifan. I play for the Golden Girls football team. Culturally, Somali people believe that it's not good for girls to play football. But I haven't done anything that my religion prohibits, and I'm not denying that I am Muslim, but I believe that I can play football if I fully cover my body. Being a girl doesn't mean that I have to stay indoors to cook and do house chores, get married and raise children. I can do everything. Allah has given me the freedom to do things, but when you're told you're just a woman, stay at home, I think it's a way of restricting my freedom. When I'm playing with boys, some laugh at me and ask, how can you play with us? They tease me and tell me I'm not capable. But after the game, they start chanting that I am better than many of them.
Sports is good for physical and mental health. And it's good that our Somali girls play football. And although it's a new thing for us, we will understand and adapt to it.
To be honest, she really has good skills. And she's better than some boys who play football with her. There are a lot of female footballers around the world. So it's absolutely wrong to abuse girls who try playing the game because they want to achieve something.
I've seen a lot of women who are afraid to face society, but I never fear them. No one has ever threatened my life, and even if they did, I won't stop. I will die when my time is over. I will never stop what I am passionate about because someone has threatened me. My biggest dream is to play for the national football team. My favorite football player is Mata, who plays for Brazil. I hope that one day I'll be able to play for international teams. I want to become a world superstar.
Now, we're going to Cameroon to meet four amazing young girls who are tackling a serious problem in their country, the lack of blood in hospitals. It's estimated that Cameroon needs 400,000 bags of blood to treat people and save lives each year. But they have less than a quarter of that. So this group of students who call themselves Geek Girls have come up with a clever solution.
Passionate about computers and technology, these four schoolgirls, also known as the Geek Girls, have decided to put their knowledge to help others. They've created an app to connect people who need blood with potential donors. So, how did they come up with this idea?
Many members of our family passed away due to the lack of blood.
For the past 3 months, the girls did extensive research on the subject and discovered a very different reality.
We carried out questionnaires. We interviewed people and many of them told us that when you get to the blood bank, they tell you to bring people with you to give blood, or alternatively, you have to pay extortionate prices.
L'autre alternative sera de payer le sang utilisé à des coûts exorbitants.
And it's on that basis that the Geek Girls developed the Hemo app. How it works is very simple. Donors and recipients only need to register themselves.
People who need blood just need to click on search donors. They are asked to give their blood types and location, and then a list come up with a matching people.
For 4 months after its launch, Hemo app has been downloaded for free by more than 50 people. Its success is pushing the team to want to do even better.
We want to use an accessible language so we can increase the app's users. We also want to improve the app's design and its coding problems.
The girls hope one day to export Hemo app beyond the borders of Cameroon.
We want to make this app from national level to an international level. We want to export the app in every single country in the Central African region and in the most suitable language.
Today, the Gig Girls are working on a French version of the app in order to hopefully save more lives.
Yeah, you go Gig Girls, great stuff. Now, many of us are familiar with Afrobeats, right? But one singer from Zimbabwe is using her own style to update the popular music genre. Her name is Vali, and she told Nora how her mixture of identities and feminism influences her songs.
Valerie Sibanda, also known as Vali Music, grew up speaking Ndebele and Shona due to her South African and Zimbabwean heritage. She told me why it was important to represent her identity in her music.
I really felt it was important to represent my people. We don't have enough representation. We have Western Africa, but we don't have enough of a Southern African representation.
What were your struggles as a female artist?
The industry is quite male dominated. So I feel my challenges come from where I'm from, being a singer who sings sort of like house, Afro house, and everyone is doing the Afrobeat style, and then being a female. So we are a minority, and I am trying to push through. My music is all about empowerment.
So tell me a bit about that song, Mina Nawe. What does it mean, and how is it empowering to young women?
Mina Nawe basically means me and you. Talking about a situationship, and it's about a woman coming out of that situationship and setting the tone and saying, hey, let's turn this into something real, as opposed to waiting for a guy to set the tone.
What's your advice to young girls who want to be a singer like you?
My advice is to really go after your dreams. Start small, put videos on YouTube. Social media is free. I mean, you don't need to have loads of money to get started. So I would say if you're in Africa, get a phone, get your cell phone out, your mobile phone, shoot a video, post it up, and that's how most people get noticed. And that's definitely a start.
Why is there such a barrier for young female African artists to get out there?
I believe the sound is so different. It's not something we're used to. We're used to a commercial, more pop sound, but I guess, we already have so many people who are successful, Tiwa Savage, so there are opportunities for us. It's just us creating that market and seeing it for ourselves.
So who's your target audience?
My main audience is, I think it's Southern Africans. Mainly my sound is it's an SA house, Afro house, so it appeals to the South African market. I think growing up in Zim, there's such close ties with South Africa. My music was influenced by that. I grew up listening to people like Vusi Hlongo, you know, Lucky Dube, like real, those are the pioneers of music in South Africa. And I go there every year just so I can stay up to date with the sound there. And yeah, and I visit home as well. I make sure I'm well grounded.
So what's next for Vali?
I am so excited. I'm shooting a music video at the end of this month. And I can't share too much, but it's all about female empowerment. It's all about pushing the whole African agenda and showing how powerful we are, and we are rising in society.
Come and tell me what is on your mind. I'm trying to figure out what is inside. You are so complicated.
I love it.
Now, our next guest is a talented tailor who uses her passion for people and fashion to create a clothesline to bridge the gap between blind and sighted fashion lovers. Tapiwa Ngwiza was inspired to create her designs after she struggled to communicate with her blind classmates at school back in Zimbabwe. She told us how she does it.
I believe it is important that people from the blind community have fashion that represents and celebrates them. My name is Tapua Dingwisa. I'm a fashion designer who incorporates braille into my designs. I was born and raised in Zimbabwe, and I went to a school that was also attended by blind children. When I was at that school, I didn't get to interact with many of them due to social barriers. Now, as a fashion designer, I've bridged the gap by creating a collection that is inclusive and meaningful as a form of communication and social inclusion within the community. All the designs have got personal and motivational messages.
This one says, I'm pursuing my dreams and determined to reach my goal.
It's a very challenging yet innovative process, which includes a lot of research, experimentations for braille embroidery and embossing.
This one says, be happy with what you have while working for what you want.
In its very nature, fashion is about inclusivity, and my braille designs are made for all, to uplift and to inspire all. I don't see why blind people should not have great fashion, just like the sighted.
This one means confidence and determination.
Our beautiful clothes. Now our next guest hasn't let anything get in the way of his dreams. Amon was born with a disability, which means that he only has the use of one leg. But he's determined to break the world high jump record in para sports. Check this out.
My name is Amon Ibrahim Okechukwu. I'm in high jumper. Being disabled growing up, it wasn't easy. There were a lot of challenges, but anyhow, thank God. Having one leg does not make me different. I feel normal like every other person. I can do anything that any other normal person can do. I decided to go into high jump because I found out my talent and I like high jump. During my primary school, during our inter-sports, I saw where they were doing high jump, so I decided to give it a try. So I discovered that I was perfect, so I decided to take it to the next level as a profession. Okay, my daily activities, when I wake up in the morning, I do pray, then I do more of fitness in my room. I do fitness, and after then I do assist a friend of mine in Isaba Cafe. My dream is to break the world record in high jump para sports.
Wow, he makes it look easy, doesn't he? But remember, don't try those tricks at home. Now that's all from the BBC What's New team this week. We'll see you next time. Bye.